So once again, good morning. The issues which we are going to present here and discuss are connected with the policy on energy in Central Asia. Now, the obvious question is, what is the connection between the overall topic, theme of our conference, leadership and policy on energy issues? In my opinion, that connection is rather obvious. We are going to discuss the situation, political and economic, in five post-Soviet Central Asian states that have a rather short history of national sovereignty. It's 20 years. And that history is at the same time rather difficult. It has a lot of problems, political, economic, social. The countries are ruled by authoritarian regimes, probably at this time with the exception of Kyrgyzstan, but that exception is very particular, since actually the previous president was overthrown in a violent uprising, and there was a great loss of human life during that uprising in 2010. Now they are experimenting with the parliamentary democracy, and actually the situation, in my opinion, remains very unstable. We are facing in Kyrgyzstan a galaxy of weak leaders, none of whom so far proved himself or herself to be capable to cope with very difficult issues of social, economic, and political development in Kyrgyzstan. While four other Central Asian countries, that is Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and Tajikistan, are ruled by authoritarian regimes, and they have their own share of problems, including the problem of power succession. I repeat again that the story of their national sovereignty is very short. The problems are huge. How to cope with these problems? In the post-Soviet period, probably the majority of post-Soviet states tried, including Russia, tried to use natural resources for the purposes of national development. And among these resources in Central Asia, the energy resources are most important and, in fact, are in great demand. Those energy resources are different. Hydrocarbon resources mostly are concentrated in Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and Uzbekistan. Uranium is in Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan is actually only second to Australia in the size of uranium deposits. And while the other two Central Asian states, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, are rich in hydropower resources, while they are lacking carbon resources. So there is a certain diversity in availability of different energy resources in the region. But we today are going to concentrate mostly on the analysis of the policy of using carbon resources for national development by three most important and largest Central Asian states: Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan. Speaking about these hydrocarbon resources, we may emphasize the fact that even though Central Asian region is lagging behind the Middle East in the size of these resources, it may nevertheless play an important role in the world oil and gas production and trade in the 21st century. And in fact, we are observing the growing interest of extra-regional powers, including China, United States, European countries, in the exploration of those resources, in investment in those resources. And from the point of view of Central Asian leaders, their use of these resources is, of course, important, but they have to overcome very serious difficulties in making the most effective use of the resources. What are those difficulties? Firstly, they are connected with the threats and challenges to the political and economic stability of the region. These threats are coming from the forces of international terrorism, religious extremism, and organized crime, whose activities actually escalated in the region over the last two decades. Moreover, the situation may get even worse after the withdrawal of the coalition forces from the neighboring Afghanistan after 1914, and radicals coming to power there. Yesterday there was a workshop on the situation in Afghanistan and neighboring Pakistan, and actually it has been admitted that the return of the Taliban to power in Afghanistan is more than likely after the withdrawal of the coalition forces from these countries. Another important source of political instability around Central Asia is connected with the deteriorating situation in and around another of their neighbor, that's about Iran. What is going to happen in and around Iran, no one really knows, but if the worst case scenario is taken into account, the situation in Central Asia will be very seriously affected. The second group of challenges and threats, well, not threats, but challenges to the use of Central Asian energy resources is closely connected with the problems of the legal regime of the Caspian Sea. The regime, which originally was based on the two treaties between Iran and Soviet Russia, and then the Soviet Union in 1921-1940, these treaties actually are no longer valid, because there are now not two sovereign states, but five literal states, Caspian literal states, and the legal problems between them still remain. They are not yet resolved, and the problems are concentrated, first of all, on the issue: what is the Caspian? The lake or the inland sea, and because of that lack of understanding, lack of common position on this issue, the legal regime is yet to be resolved on the use of energy resources there. Basically, if not in letter, but at least in spirit, the literal states, the Caspian literal states, agree that the surface of the Caspian Sea is to be considered as common surface, without borders, while the sea bottom is to be divided. But how to divide the sea bottom, that is still an open question. Russia, Kazakhstan, and Azerbaijan, they more or less agreed on the division of the sea bottom, while the position of Turkmenistan and Iran remain the source of problems for themselves and for their neighbors. And there are still tensions on the issue of what particular deposits belong either to Turkmenistan or Iran. The third group of problems that Central Asian states confront while developing their energy resources is connected with the fact that they are all landlocked countries. And they have to resolve the problem of transportation of their energy resources to the world market, both by developing the already existing routes, mostly across the territory of Russia, as well as by establishing new energy export routes. So this is a very important part of their economic policies. And while they take into account all possible options to resolve this issue, their clearly preferred objective is to have a multi-directional energy route policy using all possibilities transporting their energy resources, not only across the Russian territory, but also across the territory of Iran and connecting with Azerbaijan on the other shore of the Caspian Sea, and now more and more by exporting energy resources to China. So this is very roughly the group of challenges that are connected with the use of energy resources by the Central Asian political regimes. And I again emphasize the fact that these regimes depend on their stability, their future, their leadership, well, very much depend upon their ability to use to the best in the best possible way of these energy resources. So today we are going to listen to presentations on these issues by my colleagues from Russian Academy of Sciences from different institutes. Unfortunately, the third of our, the fourth of our colleagues, Dr. Zhukov from the Institute of World Economy and International Relations, fell ill on the day of his departure for Seoul from Moscow and was unable to come here. But we are fortunate to have here Dr. Igor Tomberg sitting next to me, who is director of Center for Energy and Transport from the Institute of Oriental Studies. He is also a professor at the Moscow State Institute of International Relations in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And he consults major Russian and international banks and energy companies on oil, refined products, and petrochemicals. His publications include a book on China energy resources and energy issues, numerous articles, and book chapters on global energy problems. Next to him is Dr. Vladimir Matveyev, who is leading research scholar from another Russian academic institute, Institute of the Far Eastern Studies, who also was a counselor at the Committee on Federation Affairs and Regional Policy for the Russian State Duma in 1994 to 2004. He was a senior research fellow at the Institute of Gas Industry from 74 to 78, and he has particular knowledge on the question of price formation. My name is Gennady Chufrin. I am a member of the governing board of the Institute of World Economy and International Relations. In my previous positions included also deputy directorship of the Institute of Oriental Studies, and from 2002 to 2008 I worked as a project leader at the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, CIPRI, where I was in charge of several major international projects connected with the Russian foreign policy in Asia. So this is the group of Russian scholars that are going to present their views on the issues I mentioned. And I'm sure their presentations will give you some additional thoughts and information, and we shall have a very productive meeting. Thank you very much, and with this, I am giving the floor to Dr. Todd.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And my topic is oil and gas sector in the economy of Central Asian countries. And first of all, I should brief you just very shortly about the economic situation in these countries. Well, first of all, we are talking about Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan, its Central Asian countries. And sometimes in energy reasons, we add Azerbaijan, which is not geographically in the Central Asia, but is an integral part of the energy balance of this Caspian region, and it's quite a sizable producer of oil and gas at the moment. So, Central Asian gross domestic product annual rates, growth rates, are quite decent, and at the moment, Central Asia should just keep up the momentum of 6.1% in this year and 6.2% in the next year, as predicted. After a very serious fall in economic development in the early 90s, up to 1996, I think, where all the countries had negative growth rates, now it's more or less okay, and it was record in 1928 year, then crisis, and now the situation more or less stable. The same situation with inflation, which decreased from 11.2% in 2007 to 9% in 2011 year. For this year, it's predicted 7.2%. So macroeconomic stability is more or less guaranteed, especially in the countries which produce and export hydrocarbons. These countries are very, very unequal, which we can see. Well, I prepared a presentation, but unfortunately we don't have facilities, so I have to describe my own pictures. per capita gross national product volume is very different, and by the international standards, these countries are categorized as low-income countries, except maybe Kazakhstan, which is a middle-income country, but mostly because of very small, relatively small population, big territory, and big production of oil. The three oil exporting countries have significantly higher per capita incomes than the non-oil exporters, indicating a divergence in prosperity within the region. So if Kazakhstan has $7,600 per capita, for example, Tajikistan has only $800 per capita income. So it's a very big, to my mind, difference. And if we talk about all the region countries, 40% of the population is under the poverty line. It's quite a serious figure, and even in oil and gas producing countries, we still meet quite high level of poverty. So Central Asia is an emerging and a rising energy region. The development of energy sector in five countries of post-Soviet Central Asia and also Azerbaijan is defined by two main factors. On the one hand, a number of countries of the region, Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, have large commercial reserves of oil and gas. Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan in particular also have large reserves of natural uranium. Just drawing on the rich energy resources, these countries became serious energy exporters. Well, International Energy Agency estimates that the Caspian region, including Azerbaijan, contains 7.5% of the world proven oil reserves, while remaining recoverable reserves are closer to 5% of the world total. The bulk of these reserves are in Kazakhstan, with smaller volumes in Azerbaijan and Turkmenistan. The region's share of global proven and recoverable natural gas reserves is around 7% of the world, mostly concentrated in Turkmenistan. Since Caspian region is yet relatively unexplored, this estimates could be revised upwards significantly in the nearest future. Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and to a much less extent Uzbekistan are now net exporters of energy, especially Kazakhstan in oil and Turkmenistan in natural gas. Last year, all region countries of the region produced 140 million tons of crude oil and 160 billion cubic meters of gas. Well, 80% of oil was produced in Kazakhstan, and the same 80 plus something percent of gas was produced in Turkmenistan. Well, Uzbekistan is producing approximately 60 billion cubic meters per year. It's quite sizable production, but with 30 million population, it has to cover domestic supply and needs by natural gas. Plus, Uzbekistan is supplying gas to the neighboring countries such as Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and northern Kazakhstan. The International Energy Agency predicts that Caspian oil production will rise from 2.9 million barrels per day in the 90s year to a peak of 5.4 million barrels per day in the later half of the 20s. Most of that oil will be exported to international market. So Caspian, Central Asian and Caspian region will become very big and important supplier to the global market with the share of 9%, approximately the same as Latin America produces now, but I think Latin American tomatoes will produce more because of Brazilian oil industry. The projected expansion of natural gas output is equally impressive, with production forecast to almost double from around 160 billion cubic meters in 9 years to 300 and more billion cubic meters up to 35 years. And around 130 billion cubic meters of this gas will be available for export. And Caspian countries will have 11% of the global gas sales. Well, the smaller Central Asian republics, such as Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, they are not energy players in hydropower, hydrocarbons, but they have quite sizable hydropower resources because it's mountain countries and they have plenty of very serious rivers. And Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, 43% and 41% of the demand for energy resources, respectively, is covered by import. The remainder is hydropower. And what's interesting, traditionally, very substantial part of Kazakhstan imported oil and petroleum, mostly from Russia and Kazakhstan, are re-exported to China. Well, on the other hand, with quite sizable production growth rates and volumes, the energy sector of all former Soviet republics, which now became independent states, retains some typological features inherited from the Soviet period of development. Any significant investment in the modernization of this sector in production facilities, transport and transport infrastructure, as well as in the housing sector, over the past 20 years has not been done or done very little. So very distinctive feature of this economy is low energy efficiency in production and consumption. For energy consumption per unit of GDP, the Central Asian countries, in particular Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan, are among the world leaders. Recently, the post-Soviet economies, with the exception of Armenia, Azerbaijan and Georgia, which are countries of Caucasian region, were among the 20 countries with the highest energy consumption per GDP unit. So it means that Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan are among the most energy-wasteful economies of the world. This also means that economic growth in these countries very closely correlates with the magnitude of energy consumption. Well, electrical capacities of in Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan in recent years was not modernized, and only very strong and Soviet energy heritage led these countries to avoid a complete economic and social collapse, and even this Soviet legacy even led these countries to support positive growth in this century. The forecast of future production and consumption of energy resources in Central Asia and Azerbaijan is very complicated. First of all, because these countries are very heavily dependent on international market and international market prices. They all are also very much dependent on foreign investments. And political stability in the region is very questionable, as it was said by Mr. Chufrin. Economic and energy transit in post-Soviet states of Central Asia, especially in Tajikistan and Kazakhstan, is not yet finished. And the power system is are close to exhaustion. So we have very great uncertainty about the prospects for economic development on these countries. As it was already said, all countries of the region are landlocked and located quite far from the main consuming markets of hydrocarbons. Well, except maybe China, but still Turkmenistan and Kazakhstan are also very far geographically from China and other markets. But these countries are making very serious efforts to start at last export diversification and trying to avoid dependence on Russian gas pipeline system. Well, it's a part of former Soviet gas and oil pipeline system, quite old but still in functioning. And for the moment, well, most of oil export from Kazakhstan, most part, goes either to Russia or via Russian territory to Europe on export. And in gas, natural gas situation a little bit another, because having quite sizable capacity of export to Russia, Turkmenistan is supplying now only 10 billion cubic meters per year, and Gazprom does not accept more because of price reasons. And first, it was always considered as a big success of Turkmenistan and other Central Asian countries is a pipeline to China. It's quite a big pipeline. Today's capacity is 30 billion cubic meters, and the prospective capacity is up to 60 or even 65 billion cubic meters per year. But now it works quite slowly, and for 2 years, from 9 years, this export takes place only for 2 years now. They managed to supply 17 billion cubic meters to China, and mostly because of price reasons. For Chinese side, this price is a little bit high, and CNPC and PetroChina, which are importing Turkmenistan gas, they have quite serious financial losses, which they have to cover by domestic production. But the system of gas prices in China now is in transition and modernization, and the direction is a price rise, but very slowly, because Chinese government is very much afraid of inflation. Turkmenistan gas also goes to Iran, not very much, approximately 10-12 billion cubic meters per year. And all other projects, well, you see, they are very discussable and they are very questionable. Such projects as a southern corridor to Europe from Turkmenistan via Azerbaijan to Europe, as Mr. Chufrin already put it, legal problems of Caspian Sea are not yet solved, and I seriously doubt that they can be solved, for Turkmenistan benefit. And this Trans-Caspian pipeline, which is very broadly discussed in the newspapers, in the European Union, I think it's very difficult and not very possible situation, to my mind, such as so-called Trans-Afghanistan pipeline, which is now even a contract for the construction was signed, and they plan to start pipeline construction this year, but the political situation and the military situation in Afghanistan is very difficult, and I don't think they will risk to start construction. Well, what else? Well, I think that's it.
Well, I think you will have an opportunity to add to your presentation later on, probably during the session of questions and answers. But at this moment, what I would like to emphasize following your presentation, include 3 points. First, as you can see, these countries are relatively rich in hydrocarbon resources, and especially if you consider it on the per capita basis, they are indeed very rich, and for the purposes of political stability, economic progress, and social benefits, these resources could be a very important source. But the second point, which is very important, is that until recently, the proven and recoverable reserves of carbon resources in this area were based on the estimates done during the Soviet period, during the Soviet times. The geological surveys of oil and gas resources since that time were either not carried out at all or started to be carried out only recently, which make it difficult for the governments to work out a sustainable economic policy, taking into account the possible benefits from the sale of their carbon resources in the international market. At the same time, there are solid reasons to believe that, for instance, gas resources of Turkmenistan are much more than they are really announced right now. And probably Turkmenistan, being already one of the largest gas exporters in the world, may become even more important in the next few years. We shall have a special presentation by Dr. Matveev, who is going to speak about the gas export policy of Turkmenistan. And I would like to give him the floor, and please.
Ladies and gentlemen, my report, Turkmenistan gas export risks and opportunities. Over the past decade, significant gas reserves have been confirmed in Turkmenistan. Last year, BP annual report proven gas reserves in Turkmenistan were estimated at only 8 trillion cubic meters. This still puts the country in the fourth place in the world, after Russia, Iran, and Qatar. Such reserves, in any case, may guarantee gas production in Turkmenistan at the level of up to 100 billion cubic meters annually, at least for the next 50 years. In 2007, with the discovery of the unique field, Southern Yolatan Osman draw dramatic surge in interest among major players in the world gas market. Its projected reserves are estimated by various parties at 21 trillion cubic meters. This field is now positioned as a principal resource base for almost all the leading export destinations of Turkmen gas. The high cost of development of most new fields present additional risks in the gas sector of Turkmenistan. They are associated with large depths of deposit located at 3 to 5 kilometers and high content of aggressive components such as hydrogen sulfide. This required greater investment in mining and for preparation of natural gas for transportation. Yet the main problem of further development of Turkmenistan gas industry is not a problem of resources, but transportation of gas for export. Its resolution is the cornerstone of a long-term strategy of the country gas industry. According to the development program of oil and gas industry of Turkmenistan until 2030, the Turkmen authorities plan to increase gas production in the country fourfold up to 250 billion cubic meters yearly. But these plans, in our opinion, are highly exaggerated. Many international experts also estimated an export potential of Turkmenistan until 2030. According to Cambridge Energy Research Associated, for instance, made in last year, the export potential of Turkmenistan will reach about 56 billion cubic meters by 2030. The International Energy Agency assessed its potential at 90 billion cubic meters. In our opinion, the most realistic figures range between 90 to 100 billion cubic meters. According to Turkmenistan's strategic plans, intensive development of export pipeline in various directions may be undertaken, provided that the full financing of their construction will virtually come from its partners. Currently, Turkmenistan exports gas in three directions: to the north to Russia, to the east to China, and to the south to Iran. Export of gas from Turkmenistan is growing very fast. Gas to Iran is supplied by two pipelines, total capacity of 20 billion cubic meters. However, at present, Turkmenistan exports annually to Iran not more than 7 billion cubic meters. These supplies cover only domestic needs, the northeastern regions of Iran, and their volume is highly dependent on existing contract prices. The transit of Turkmen gas via Iran to Europe is out of the question because of international sanctions. Iran is ready to act as a transit country for gas transportation from Turkmenistan to the gas liquefaction plant, which may be built at the Arabian Sea shore. This could be a real opportunity for Turkmenistan's gas to enter the global LNG market. Until recently, the Russian direction was the main one of the Turkmenistan gas export. But due to the sharp decline in Ukraine's gas consumption and reduced demand in Europe, Gazprom is now actually buys on 10 billion cubic meters of gas from Turkmenistan per year. Turkmenistan gas export to China has become its leading direction and continues to develop rapidly. In the current year, 40 billion cubic meters of gas will be exported via this pipeline. The parties involved agreed to increase the supply of gas through this pipeline in the near future up to 65 billion cubic meters. Such fast development is due to several factors. First, China is undertaking most of the technical and financial costs. Beijing has provided loans, technological equipment, construction works. Second, the Turkmenistan government agreed to a relatively low contract price, $250 per thousand cubic meters. So China as well as Russia is against the construction of a Trans-Caspian gas pipeline. The price of Turkmenistan gas to Europe could be substantially higher than the current price China is paying. Therefore, the Chinese side understands what is at stake. However, the China-Turkmen gas cooperation carries certain risks for the Turkmen side a tie to a single consumer may lead to becoming overly depends on its terms. In case of an upward trend in world gas prices, Turkmenistan will bear losses the sale of gas to China due to comparatively low prices. Also, in the medium term, supply of current volumes of Turkmenistan gas may well exceed actual demand in China because of lack of distribution networks that are needed for gas consumption. Besides, transportation of gas over this distance of 7,000 miles to Guangzhou, they're clearly unprofitable for China. Already, Chinese gas importing companies, PetroChina in particular, lose $130 per thousand cubic meters of imported gas. The most talked about and overly politicized is the direction of Trans-Caspian gas pipeline with a link to Nabucco. There are concerns over the commercial viability of the project. Now there is a high uncertainty about the possible methods of delivery of Turkmen gas to Europe. The uncertainty stems from the fact the line pipelines across the Caspian Sea before the settlement of its status would be contrary of existing agreements in the regions. In this case, the main risk is not even so much about the method and the transportation route, but about the availability of necessary gas resources for the fulfillment of obligations. Virtually all international consulting organizations predict a much lower gas export capacity than what the Turkmen leadership officially voices. Long-term gas supply obligation by Turkmenistan have already reached 120 billion cubic meters. A prospective additional increase of gas supply to China will further exacerbate the problem of finding reserves of Turkmen gas for export. In these circumstances, signing additional agreement for gas supplies to Europe will only increase the risk on non-fulfillment of all contractual obligations by Turkmenistan. Today, a number of initiates of this project, particularly the USA, have recognized an unlikely realization of the Nabucco project. In most scenarios, by 2030 gas export from Turkmenistan are limited by those to China, Iran, and Russia. Also, South Asia consumers may be added to the list.
Well, thank you very much. And let me just offer a few comments on the latest presentation by Dr. Matveev. Actually, again, we are observing a typical situation. There is an abundant resource base of carbon resources, in this case of gas resources. And on the other, the problem of transportation. The problem of transportation which Turkmenistan was trying to resolve by first by increasing its export via the Russian territory, but due to the reasons already described, that is the fall in world prices on gas, the intake of Turkmenistan gas to Russia was radically reduced from expected 30 billion cubic meters to 10 billion cubic meters now. The second option was to sell gas to China. Indeed, several gas pipelines have already been commissioned, and China at the present moment is by far the largest consumer of Turkmenistan gas. But here we are having a clear case of over-dependency on one market. China has already invested over $8 billion in the development of transport infrastructure from Turkmenistan to China. And Turkmenistan now is considering the usefulness of being over-dependent on one market. And they are searching for other options, and that option has already been mentioned. That is the construction of the so-called TAPI gas pipeline, which may be operational only in case of resolution of the Afghan problem. So there are several countries involved in the construction of, in implementation of that project. Well, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, and of course India and Pakistan. India and Pakistan are becoming more important players in the use of Central Asian resources. They are very much interested in the implementation of the TAPI project. But first of all, the problem of resolution of the conflict in Afghanistan is to be achieved. There is what already Dr. Matveev mentioned here. There was a speculation about the Nabucco project. Nabucco was supposed to be an outlet of Turkmenistan to Europe. But the stumbling block, the first and the major stumbling block, was the inability of Turkmenistan to build a Trans-Caspian gas pipeline, because the other participants, other literal states, especially Russia and Iran, are very much against the construction of the Trans-Caspian oil and gas pipelines because of the environmental reasons. And in fact, in 1996, in 2006, all five literal states, Caspian literal states, agreed with this point of view and decided against the construction of such pipelines. It was quite recently that the Financial Times reported that the European stockholders of the Nabucco project, that is German supply and trading company, Romanian Transgas, Bulgarian Bulgargaz, Hungarian company, as well as Turkish Botas, decided that because of the insufficient resource base to reduce by half both the length and the capacity of the planned gas pipeline, the Nabucco pipeline. Now it will be constructed only from Austria up to the Bulgarian border with Turkey, and its capacity is going to be limited up to 10 billion cubic meters per annum. So again, we are seeing, well, the transportation problem remains, the legal problem remains, and also the efficiency of using the returns from gas export by the Central Asian states. In my opinion, the best use of the profits received from gas export and oil export to the world market is demonstrated by Kazakhstan. In fact, during the last 20 years, Kazakhstan made a very major leap forward in the economic development, increased substantially, well, it was already mentioned by Dr. Tomberg, the per capita income of the population, and now is Kazakhstan is heading for additional developments and economic projects that are aimed at transforming, modernizing the economic structure of this country. So obviously these plans, objectives being economic in nature are aimed, are targeted at social and political goals and well, are aimed at establishing the stability in the region. That stability, unfortunately, remains to be questioned by several factors, both of the domestic and external nature. So this is, well, the overall description of the situation in the development of energy resources in Central Asian states, the linkage of that development with the social and political goals set up by the governments of these countries. Now, let me just use the remaining time of our session for questions from the floor. So you are welcome to ask questions. Yeah. Please, identify yourself, please.
Thank you. I'm Ellen Lapson from the Stimson Center in Washington, and I wonder if we could connect this discussion about the energy prospects within these countries to the question of regional security and regional stability, whether you see any patterns for the countries of Central Asia to cooperate bilaterally or in a multilateral forum on energy development, transportation obviously lends itself to cross-border cooperation. But you mentioned the Afghan conflict, and I wonder if the countries of Central Asia are active participants in the international meetings on the future of Afghanistan, and whether there's an energy component to that, whether they could in fact contribute to Afghan stability through energy cooperation, as opposed to just waiting for the conflict to be over so that they can develop their own energy interests. So it's a little bit about regional cooperation. And in that respect, is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization at all relevant to this discussion? Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to answer that? Okay, all right. You start, you begin, and then I'll continue.
Sorry. Well, I begin from the cooperation, because it's a very difficult question in this region. Cooperation and competition, it's always a problem. And for example, if you take this Trans-Caspian pipeline, there is not only transportation problem, there is also a problem of rivalry. And Azerbaijan doesn't need Turkmen gas on Azerbaijanian side of Caspian Sea, because it's also a competitor on the way to Europe, which Azerbaijan now is trying to export its gas to Europe for good price. Now it's a problem because there is Turkish transition and Turkish prices. A big battle between Baku and Ankara on the price matters. And I think Turkey is winning. And if you add sizable volumes of Turkmenistan gas, negotiation position of Azerbaijan will be much more weak. The same story with Iran, for example. Also, neither Iran nor Russia, they don't need Turkmen gas in Europe. That's why this cooperation, not exactly impossible, but still very difficult. What about intra-regional cooperation? Well, as I told you, Uzbekistan is supplying its gas to Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, and now Uzbekistan is the main source of gas supply to these two countries. Because these two countries are cut from Turkmenistan, sometimes in this very period there is sort of economic war between Uzbekistan and Tajikistan. And Uzbekistan closed gas transit to Tajikistan, and the energy situation in Tajikistan became very, very crucial and very difficult. And in this cooperation, and not cooperation, but rivalry, we should add a problem of water. It's a very difficult and very old problem, because all rivers are coming from Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan mountains down to Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan to supply agriculture. And agriculture is very crucial industry for Uzbekistan, for example, and millions of people can just starve without this water. But you see, Tajikistan is planning to construct hydropower stations, big hydropower stations on this water, and will have technically to cut these rivers from Uzbekistan. Uzbekistan doesn't want it, and this is a quite serious clashes between two countries. So my personal opinion, I don't quite believe in this cooperation. Well, unless maybe Kazakhstan, which is quite reasonable in policy and trying to arrange such cooperation. All other countries, they behave like kids sometimes. It's very funny, but still it's the same.
Well, I don't know about kids, but in fact the confrontation between among the Central Asian states on the issues of the use of water resources and energy resources sometimes is getting out of hand and becomes very, very sharp. During the Soviet times, the use of regional water resources was actually governed from the center in Moscow. Nowadays, all of them are independent sovereign states, and they conduct their national policies, which more than often in their implementations contradict each other, and indeed this is one of the most serious problems in regional energy and water policies. Now to that part of your question which is linked to the situation in Afghanistan. None of the Central Asian states is taking any active part in resolution of the Afghan issues, either politically or economically. Potentially, as I said, they are prepared to construct the Tapi gas pipeline. Well, also, Tajikistan is already providing electricity from the hydropower stations to the northern regions of Afghanistan and is prepared to increase the export of electricity to that country. So potentially there are certain plans of increasing cooperation with Afghanistan in this particular area. But again, much will depend on the future of resolution, the final settlement of the Afghan political situation. Now, about the possible role of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So far, there is none. There is none. Shanghai Cooperation Organization is yet to win its role in the regional resolution of regional problems outside of the geographical area of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization itself. In my opinion, that should be done, and should be done at as quickly as possible. But so far, I repeat, there is no role of Shanghai Cooperation Organization at all. Well, next question, please. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Adnan Tansir from Carnegie Endowment's Energy Plan Program. I have a question regarding Russian Turkmen gas relations in the future. Looking at Russia's own supply trends regarding gas, on the one hand, you have Gazprom with major plans for production increase. You also have independent gas producers which are very fast increasing their production. This is one. And on the other hand, the demand trends for Russian gas at the moment, as you described, there has been substantial decrease in Ukraine, which was a major market, and also the future about sales in Europe. It's very hard to predict how it will be impacted, given Gazprom's relatively rigid pricing stance in Europe, for example. Now, given these two trends, I just wonder, what do you think about the future need of, within Russia for importing gas from Turkmenistan? You mentioned that there has been a drastic drop in the amount that is being imported. Do you think in the future Russia will ever need to import more than that? And if not, what are the implications for Russian Turkmen relations?
Thank you.
Well, I think that in the future... Well, to my mind, Russia will always need Turkmen gas in certain volumes because the system works the next. Russian southern part and the Siberian part is supplied by Turkmen gas. It's much cheaper than you get it from the north. And these volumes will be increased as internal and domestic consumption will increase nevertheless. But such big volumes as was contracted last year, or 8 years, seems to me, they signed for almost 50 billion cubic meters per year. It's nonsense. We'll never need such volumes, especially for this price. You know that in the 6 year, Russia agreed, Gazprom, because Gazprom has monopoly for export and even for import of gas and gas products, signed a contract very equal, on equal level with European prices. And after the crisis, this price became too much for Gazprom, and they refused to decrease seriously import, and they don't have this take-or-pay conditions. That's why Gazprom just stopped import and limited it to 10 billion cubic meters. So, well, I don't quite agree that Europe will seriously decrease import of Gazprom gas, and I think minimal level of 150 billion per year will remain as minimum, and maybe more, because Gazprom is planning to increase supplies to Europe in the nearest future, mostly because of Fukushima and the German atomic policy. Nuclear policy, yes. So,
okay, thank you. Do you have a question?
Okay, thank you. Jamala Cage from Ihwa Women's University. Mr. Chufrin, you've mentioned such a word as overdependency, and Central Asian countries, both Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan, is heavily dependent on the hydrocarbon industry in terms of its impact on the GDP composition. And don't you think that with the estimate reserves and taking into account that hydrocarbons resources are exhaustible, within nearest like 50, 60 years, the overdependency of those countries in terms of economical growth will affect and kind of destabilize the region politically? Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it is at the same time difficult and easy to forecast for the period of 50 to 60 years. Well, no one will take the responsibility of whether this forecast is correct or wrong. But, well, I shall use the opportunity to remain in the annals of history for my own forecast of what is going to happen with the export of carbon resources from Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan, not in 50 years, but let us say in 15 to 20 years. I believe that the declared policy of Kazakhstan is to reduce its dependency on the export of carbon resources by replacing it with the development of manufacturing industries, by participating in different cooperation economic schemes within cooperation with Russia and Belarus. So whether they will succeed in that is rather difficult to say, but at least what is also declared as a very coveted goal is to reduce the consumption per unit of GDP, which already been mentioned by Dr. Tomberg. Nowadays, the consumption is excessive, over-excessive. So they have to increase the efficiency in the domestic use of energy resources. With Turkmenistan, I think the situation is more predictable in a sense that the already proven gas reserves may be increased substantially if the geological surveys that are going on, well, with Yelatan deposit, gas deposit, prove to be correct. If surveys produce the expected results, then the gas reserves of Turkmenistan could be even multiplied, could be doubled. Therefore, for them, the gas resources as the principal source of financing their national economic development for the next 20 years could be very, very, will remain very, very central. Well, I think that we are reminded that we have to end our session. I would like to thank on your behalf the panelists who presented here very interesting, in my opinion, very interesting papers. And of course, I would like to thank everyone participating here in this session for the questions and the interest displayed to the topics discussed here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We will now have a short break. The second plenary session, titled Think Tanks and Crisis, will begin at 10:15. If you have not yet signed up for the networking lunch,